Okay, Hamish, so I think if you're ready, we'll make a start.
Sure.
I'll start by welcoming everyone. I'm Sarah Turner. I'm the Deputy Director for Research at the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art. And I want to start by welcoming everyone to the first research lunch of 2021. It's undoubtedly been a tough and challenging start to the new year, especially as many of us are isolated from colleagues and friends, but we hope that this hour is a chance to connect with other people who share interests. This might be the first time that some of you have connected with Paul Mellon Centre events, and a special welcome to you, and welcome back to those of you who are regular attendees. The Paul Mellon Centre is a research institute and educational charity. We're based in Bedford Square in central London, and we're part of Yale University. And whilst we're closed due to COVID restrictions, you can interact with us online through our publications, our events, and our collections. Let me walk you through the format of this online seminar today before we start and I introduce Hamish Muir. And I'll just read through these housekeeping guidelines, which you hopefully can all see online. You're automatically muted when you join the webinar, and you can only communicate verbally if the host unmutes you, which can happen during the Q&A session, which will be after Hamish's talk. The talk will last roughly for 40 minutes, give and take, and it'll be followed by a question and answer session and discussion. And we really want you to get involved and interact. And I know Hamish is really keen to hear your feedback and your questions. So really do make the most of that opportunity after the presentation. So how do you ask questions? Well, you use the virtual raise hand button, which you will see at the bottom of your screen if you have questions or a comment to make and you want to speak. And Danny, who's helping us today, our events assistant, will unmute you so that you can interact with myself and with Hamish. If you don't want to speak, that's absolutely fine. You can type your question, and please do that in the Q&A box. You can do that at any point during Hamish's talk. So if something comes to you as he's speaking, please put that question in the box and we'll come back to it after the presentation during the Q&A session. And what I'll do is I'll read out your question to Hamish, because other people can't see what you've written. And so I'll read it out and we'll get to that in the discussion. You can also use the chat box if you've got any problems, if you've got any questions, or you just want to say hello. Again, I think we're all craving ways to connect with other researchers and other people. So please, let's just use this opportunity whilst we're together for this hour to share ideas, to share thoughts and discuss things with one another. The session is being recorded today, and that gives people who can't make it at this time a chance to watch the presentation and hear about Hamish's research. And please don't take photographs during this time. That just is to respect the speaker's presentation and images that he's using in the talk. And any offensive behaviour will not be tolerated, and attendees can be removed from the webinar by the host. And so without further ado, let me introduce today's speaker. Hamish Muir is a PhD researcher investigating sustainable and ecological theatre at the Bartlett School of Architecture, UCL. Hamish's research focuses on playwriting and waste, particularly the role of script in its relationship with the production of sustainable theatre, and how waste can be used to question assumptions of theatre practices, aesthetics and meaning. His background is in civil engineering at Imperial College and art history at Christie's Education. Hamish has worked at several museums and auction houses in London and Edinburgh. He's also an independent artist, a playwright and a sustainability consultant. In 2017, Hamish established the production studio Arctic Lion, which creates sustainable experimental performance. So Hamish, Welcome. Thank you so much for starting off at this term's event. And we're all really looking forward to hearing your ideas. I know you're such an innovative thinker and practitioner. And I think this is an issue which feels so alive as we're all pondering the future of performance and craving to be back together in theatre buildings, interacting and watching performances live. So I know you're going to talk through many of those challenges and issues, which are really hot topics at the moment. So I'll hand over to you and then we'll join each other again for the Q&A session after your talk.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Sarah. And it's a pleasure to be speaking here today to all of you. And thank you for joining. I'm just going to share my screen now. And I hope you can all see that. But Happy New Year, everybody. And this is a really great way to kick off 2021. Today I'm going to be talking about my research in the environmental sustainability of theatre. Sustainability has been a growing topic of importance within the performing arts, given the awareness and urgency of action that needs to be taken to combat the effects of climate change. My focus has been on the London theatre industry primarily, and what you could arguably call conventional or traditional stage-based forms of theatre. Today I want to give you a brief introduction to my wider research area and then focus on a particular question that I'm working on at the moment around the role of the play script. And I'll discuss a few historical examples, some of my own experiments, and if time permits, and if you'll indulge me, I'll end with a very brief reading from one of those scripts before we open up for questions. So the way that I tend to start discussing this issue is from a fairly pragmatic position. Theatre set designs are these bespoke, conglomerated, sculptural constructions that are very difficult to reuse and recycle. They and sadly, they can often become waste material ending in landfill or incineration. They're very complex sculptures charged with intellectual property, a specific relationship between actor and audience. And there's an almost built-in inadaptability because they're made for a very specific place and purpose and moment in time. And to some extent, if the stage design is too adaptable to other performances, it loses some of its production value. And this is of course a very interesting and important contradiction almost to discuss within the within a sphere of sustainability and adaptability. I put up this design by Rob Hull at the Old Vic, which I went to see a few years ago, and it was a really beautiful design, rich in detail, and again I felt really captured this sort of building a very specific atmosphere for a very specific place in time. But of course, it's very difficult to define what a conventional set design looks like or what talk about set design or scenography in broad terms. So this is just simply one example of that. But as a consequence, and despite a lot of theatres really engaging with issues of sustainability and wanting to change, theatre generates a significant amount of waste. Not significant amounts in comparison to, say, the construction industry, but in principle, from my perspective, I don't think it matters so much about the tonnage, it's the principle, and whether there are creative opportunities from that. The image you're looking at now is an array of photos that I took at the National Theatre in 2019 when I was doing some field work there following a production from beginning to end. I produced a set of these photos twice a week over the course of the production. And there's a sort of absurdity to these images, intentional absurdity, finding value in devalued material. And, you know, was trying to look at waste as a as an almost archaeological descriptor of behavior, because you can tell a lot about somebody or somewhere by looking in their bin, basically. And to some extent, what I'd like to theorize is that waste can be treated as almost the subconscious of theater, in the sense that it is suppressed material, it is the backstage material, it is the periphery material, the subtextual material. And in this sense, we can tell a lot about what theatre considers to be valuable and what theatre considers to be beautiful. And so starting from that documentation of waste and employing the design philosophy of the circular economy, which is to do with redesigning the production process in order to avoid the creation of waste. I've attempted in my own work to redesign the total art of theatre holistically in terms of costume, backstage, the setting, the stage itself, the auditorium, the production process, and the conception of character and narrative for a zero waste ecologically conscious theatre. And again, the holistic nature of that is very important to me. But that's a sort of general summary of kind of some of the broader area and field that I'm interested in. And I feel that's quite important to contextualize before we go any further. But the central focus is really to do with what role does the script have to play in all of this, and whether the script can embody some of these ideas. The script exists in general, at the beginning of the conceptual process, and so it can define boundary conditions and initial intentions. It can also critique some of the ideas as well, particularly the pragmatism that I've already kind of alluded to, as the underpinnings of approaches such as the circular economy must be looked at critically and impartially. You know, I'm not necessarily advocating as that's the only way or the best way, because the circular economy is a sort of top-down system-based design approach. And so it has to be treated with scrutiny. I think what is a really important aspect of the play script in that respect is that it can simultaneously present an approach and critique that approach by applying different tones and genres. In the case of the circular economy, it can outline what that might look like speculatively, but also suggest some of the flaws, or leave it up for interpretation, not offer it as an answer. So to some extent, my research is really investigating the notion of redesigning the script, rather than redesigning the stage, albeit I'm very interested in that reciprocal relationship between the page and the stage. And today, you know, I want to give some key examples of that relationship. And as I said at the beginning, the aspect that I'm working on currently is to do with considering the play script as an art object, and whether treating the script in such terms has an impact on the form of the theatre that it can produce. In other words, by changing the page, how does that change the stage, if at all? And in terms of an ecological and sustainable theatre, the script has the ability to communicate what is staged and the way in which it is staged. That's kind of the aspect that I'm particularly interested in terms of the ethics of that, because sometimes the means and the ends can be incongruous, basically. For instance, if a theatre production has a strong environmental message, but it produces a significant amount of toxic waste in order to say that message, there's a conflict there. But by rewriting the script to put more focus on the potential architectural, constructive, material and spatial aspects of the drama, I think the script can offer a new agency to sustainable production and extend the total art of theatre to include technical, material and ethical construction. And in so doing, communicate to a plurality of different stakeholders and offer new ways of thinking about staging theatre. I briefly want to say that an experimental interest in the page and writing that's treated as an art object can be found in many other disciplines to theatre, such as concrete poetry, musical scores, architectural drawings, and text-based art. But from my initial discussion with theatre archives, there's not the same sort of tradition in theatre playwriting. And this is mainly due to the fact that the script is a means to an end, and a lot of theatre makers will know this already. The script is a blueprint. It's not a refined document. It's a sketch that is only drafted and redrafted and corrected and doodled on, really. Most working scripts evolve as the theatre production is staged, as different production companies stage them. And so there's a huge deviation and metamorphosis that goes on in this very collaborative process, which is so important to theatre as well. This is Henry Irving's prompt book, and it shows some drawings and notes that he's put on for Hamlet. And so there are other voices that are added to the script all the way along the process. But I think that still fundamentally, even though there is a gulf between the page and the stage, there is still a significance to consider in terms of what is and what is not present on the page, and how certain writing encourages certain conditions for staging, even though there is a lot to be interpreted and improvised from that position. I feel it's also important to say that there is an industry standard to the script format in a lot of cases, particularly if it's being pitched to a company, and the typography and insets and the graphic design and the font are all sort of well defined and established in that respect. And that can make this question around the script as an art object quite tricky in some ways. This is a screenshot of what comes up if you Google play script notation. And I'll direct you to the bottom line where it says, if you submit your new play to anyone, they will not read it if it's not in the proper format. Now, of course, in many ways, there's nothing wrong with having standards and accepted ways of working for all sorts of reasons. But equally, there's a huge potential area of creative experimentation that's not being explored here. And being sort of at the edge of convention and questioning conventions is surely what art is all about. But I'll say no more, because that's a very broad claim, and hope you forget that by the Q&A session. So theorizing the play script can be difficult because it's a means to an end. Scholarship can focus on the theater that is produced, or the purely literary aspects of the script. The play script can sort of exist in between all sorts of different forms. It can exist at different points within the production process as well. It can be purely a conceptual experiment. It can be a text that is sold or pitched to a theatre company. And it can be a retrospective document, such as these illustrated editions, which to some extent become entirely separated from the theatre that they produce. Their historical documentations of the performance, and simply and practically another means of revenue for writers and theatre makers. There's also a tradition around the closet drama, which is a script that is supposed to be read and not to be staged. And that's really its own art form, and it's become associated with particular genres and audiences. These are images from Robert Massin's 1966 graphic designs based on Ionesco's The Bold Soprano. And Massin kind of goes in the opposite direction to what I'm talking about today. And instead of going from page to stage, he's translated the stage to the page. And there's a clear interest in the page as a visual object and the layout of the characters and the speech in relation to each other. But it exists after the performance and almost dips into the realm of graphic novels or comic strips, where the page is used to make visual jokes that would not translate to the stage. So this is very much an end in itself, like an illustrated edition or a closet drama. Conversely, the National Theatre Archive pointed out these really interesting examples to me where the script is the stage, or the script is the performance. On the left is a show called The Total Immediate Collective Imminent Terrestrial Salvation. It's a very catchy title, where a script is in the centre of the stage, and different actors come forth and read a section of it. So it's a form of reader's theatre, and it produces a sort of polyphonic performance, but the script is used as a prop and is very sort of explicit on the page, and the action of the theatre is around reading the script. The action of reading becomes the performance, basically. On the right-hand side is Bagshaw and Thorpe's The Shape of Pain, where they experimented with captioning, a creative captioning approach, and turned the script into the set design to some extent. So the words are projected onto the surfaces, onto the set design and onto the actors as the words are being delivered. This is a rather kind of on the nose link between the page and the stage, but I think it's a really creative example and is worthy of note. Much of the examples of the script that I've found that treat the page differently are to do with voice and delivery. And perhaps it's also important to say it's very specifically the actor's voice. I'd like to return to this idea a bit later on, as I feel that the script is not just for actors and directors. And there are examples here which I'm showing that spatialize voice and use the space of the page to indicate certain focus points or orientations, and that could give a sense of the space, but in general it is more of an internal space rather than anything explicitly sort of physical or indeed environmental. Samuel Beckett, of course, is a major figure, a big example here, who's used the page to create different conditions for staging. This is an extract from Quad, which is a sort of balletic mathematical sequencing of movement that was written for television, and Beckett's sort of exploring staging geometry here. And he employs a more technical language and makes the script into a more almost didactic and directive document using anonymous actor names, just 1, 2, 3, and 4. And there's a real interest in pattern and permutation and very specific directions about lighting, sound, timing, the physical build of the actors and the stage dimensions themselves, so that everything can be can sort of build together into a climactic rhythm and be in unison. And the simplicity of the directions do allow for a lot of interpretation, of course, but there seems to be, Beckett seems to be playing with the idea of how much control over the stage can the page have, or does it have, and the idea of, and when Beckett staged quads, it developed into lots of different variations and versions, and there were a lot of revisions to the script. It was initially for two actors and then for four. Beckett deemed the initial configuration on the page was it was quite impractical, as actors had to cross paths with each other and would bump into each other not be able to keep to the proposed sequential timing of it all, which was dependent on the lighting and the music and all of the other stage conditions. Aside from the other sort of themes that Beckett might be exploring here in terms of futility or entrapment, which might have a very resonance with 2020 and 2021 at the moment. To me, there seems to be an interest in free will and self-determination by the very plain dictatorial directions, and an interest in the stage as a mechanism for action and a mechanism for pattern and music making, with humans, actors being almost used as instruments in space. Whilst it is also very collaborative, and again, it is very open to other voices being involved in this process, it to some extent is the opposite to improvisation, I would say. The next example is a dance score by Anna Halperin, and this addresses movement in space and is a much more ritualistic practice. Like Beckett, it's fairly directive, but again, very collaborative. We see a bird's eye view of different choreographic orientations of the actors and dancers moving in these kind of mandala shapes. And these diagrams are almost like architectural technical drawings, an attempt to express a sense of tone or mood through the formation of actors in plan view. Halperin talks about this as a moving art form, and that it is very open and participatory. It shifts from directing the voice to directing the body, and that's obviously because it's a choreographic exercise. But these simple formations allow the dance to be explained easily and performed by anyone. Halperin asks each participant, each dancer, to express a motivation that is important to them, whatever topic or person or issue that they are passionate about, and they are motivated and perform this dance with that individual motivation. There's also an explicitly environmental agenda with this, as it is a seasonal performance and takes place at a specific mountain site in nature and has an awareness of nature. So there is an ecological action taking place here, but to me, it's unclear really whether it is a sustainable action, as it requires people moving in shapes that can, for instance, damage the soil. And simply being in nature and being aware of nature does not necessarily help to conserve nature. And whilst it is a very open and democratic process and performance, the simple mandala shape means there is not much room for interpretation, and it still can be taken quite literally in its intentions from page to stage. The work of Sarah Kane is also really interesting in this context as well, particularly her play 4.48 Psychosis, which was staged posthumously. She specifically employs an ambiguity in the text and uses the page to express some of these themes, uses the page to express the themes in the play. For instance, she doesn't make explicit which characters should say the lines in the script at times, and she completely deviates from playwriting convention, such as using an abstracted array of numbers, which you can see at the bottom there. This is sort of displayed in one of the middle of the pages as a suggestion of the character's state of mind at that point. But it's very open for interpretations, and her stage directions or lack of stage directions are really there almost to challenge actors and directors to decode and treat the text in a different, non-literal way. She makes the actors and directors do more of the interpretive work. Theatre, of course, is steeped in a tradition of reinterpretation, finding new meaning and new representations in play scripts that can be 500 years old. But perhaps as a counterpoint almost to Beckett's Quad and Halprin's Planetary Dance, 4.48 Psychosis is the opposite of a directive text. As I've sort of alluded to before, the play script is never really dictatorial, and rightly so. There's a gulf of reinterpretation and evolution. And so, but I think what is significant here and is that Sarah Kane doesn't outline expectations. She creates the conditions for different sorts of conversations and improvisations to be had about the staging. And to me, this opening up of the dialogue between the page and the stage has a huge creative potential for sustainable theatre. The most intriguing example that I've found that tries to employ an entirely new vocabulary in the script and express the page, stage, and voice and motivation almost simultaneously are these geometric designs by David Cole. And he outlines four key characteristics of what constitutes a play script in his mind. Firstly, it must be material that actors can work with individually or as a group. There has to be some specification about the performance space. There has to be some basis for establishing a relationship between the actors. And there must be some means to arrive at a sequence of incidents. To some extent it has a narrative, although I don't think Cole would use the term narrative and is more interested in sequence. Cole sees these geometric shapes as exercises for actors to improvise from. For instance, in the top left diagram, he says to two actors, improvise a scene between two people, the dynamics of whose relationship are shown by this shape. Cole says that actually this doesn't fulfill each of his four characteristics that I just outlined, as it doesn't give a sense of the setting or the context that the actors are within, and it doesn't outline a sequence of instances either. And so he goes on to develop these other geometries, which for him give more of a gesture towards sequential progress and also the spatial relationship between characters. So For instance, in the bottom right diagram 23, where each node on the shape represents a character, and the lines between those characters represent the relationship physically and to some extent psychologically to the other characters. And as you can see, he's sequenced the shapes from 1 to 5, and so there would be a sequence of incidences going from there. Cole's later experiment takes a Buddhist meditative symbol of harmony and symmetry known as a yantra, and he asks the actor to do one of two things. Either pick out 4 points on the diagram, as you can see in the middle there, and these are just points that the actor is kind of intuitively drawn to, and then those are separated, as you can see below the diagram, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Or the actor can draw a geometry within the yantra shape, and this is in order to develop a sequence of geometric shapes, which you can see in the diagram on the right, and these will be a means to improvise from, define the setting space and the relationship between the characters. Now, there are a few issues that I have with Cole's theory of the script. For him, the script is primarily for actors directors to some extent, and as a motivation to be inspired from. And as I said earlier, I think that the script in terms of sustainable theatre should not just be for actors. It should be able to communicate to a wide range of stakeholders within theatre, on the stage and backstage. What the actors say in front of the audience is the tip of the iceberg of what the art of theatre is and can be. And there's so much potential for poetry and artistry and creativity to be employed within the script that speaks to different aspects of theatre and very much including the ethics of the production process. Also, Cole subscribes to moving away from the script as a literary medium, which has characterised a lot of post-dramatic theatre and different sorts of theatre practices in the 20th and 21st century. But again, my stance personally is that the script should not dispense of its literary creativity, because it can be used to communicate different messages with different audiences in a very complex, poetic and nuanced way. So I've given you a few examples of broadly, quite sort of canonical examples to some extent of writers who've used the script in a different way and critique them a little bit. But I'm going to give you some of my own examples now. Not that I'm comparing myself to those who've come before, very much standing on the shoulders of giants. But I've tried to kind of contend with issues of sustainability and ecology, and use the play script and the page to explore that, and start with the backstage and the stage itself. The backstage is generally not present in the script, and so I wanted to draw out the theatricality of the backstage, and specifically the waste of the backstage. In the diagram on the left, which I've had to abstract slightly for the purposes of today, I've documented the choreography of waste backstage at the National Theatre, and so measured the movement of waste and skips and bins. Again, there's an intentional absurdity to this. As I said earlier, I think the play script here offers tonal reflections on the approach that I've taken, and it almost self-satirizes the approach as well, which offers kind of different forms of knowledge. On the right-hand side is a section of the script which I've called Notes on Staging. And to some extent, this pictogram represents the set design, but it's very much interpretive and non-literal. It's supposed to be almost like a Rorschach test, where which can be used to symbolize whatever the viewer sees in the image. And these diagrams are staggered throughout the script and basically produce a set design that constructs and then deconstructs by the end of the performance. Similar to Beckett, I've looked at using a more technical language as well within the script that contrasts with a more discursive and poetic dialogue. I'm very interested in that juxtaposition of poetic and technical vocabularies, partly because of the background that I come from. But this culminated in another absurdist diagram of the entire production process, which charts the production of set elements. The lines map different design decisions to the construction process. Incidentally, I think this diagram conforms to all four of Cole's descriptors of what constitutes a script. It's a material that actors can work from. It outlines a relationship between the actors, some of whom are non-human, and there's a sense of space in that each set element gets a proportional size in relation to their construction, and it's fundamentally a timeline, a sequence of events as well. There are more examples which I'll briefly skip through as well. Again, I wanted to draw on the idea of the play script as a narrative and as a sequence. A design process is also a sequence and an evolution, and the script can be used as a device to chart and critique and develop that design process. The script can also as well play with language, grammar, alphabet, vocabulary, in order to refocus the staging towards the material, spatial, and environmental aspects of the stage, playing with the idea of consequence and questioning convention. Lastly, I'll end with this example, picking up on the point that the script is not just for the actor. This is a visual script which I created in 2019. The images chart the supply chain of a piece of plywood, which gives a sense of the embodied energy of that material from cradle to grave. The accompanying dialogue has a double meaning, and the dialogue alone, taken off the page, is a short poetic monologue delivered by an individual character talking about their sense of self. But when put with the images, they have a different meaning. And so the visuals are saying one story and the words are saying another. And I wanted to try and have this kind of conversation between the images and the words on the page. The idea being that the people who read the physical script are those who work backstage, directors, designers, stage managers, craftspeople, draftspeople. Meanwhile, the audience who would come to see the show, they don't see these images, and these images wouldn't necessarily need to reflect the set design or the staging in any way. They just would hear the actor alone. And so again, the point is that I'm trying to communicate to different audiences on different levels and through different means. So I will now end with a very short reading if there is time, and as I say, if you'll indulge me, and then we'll open up for questions. Theatre is obviously a bit better in the flesh, so I hope there'll be some performative power online. But I will read this to you, and you have the script in front of you as well. We begin at the end, bugged, rugged, dark bark to rend, knotted, rotted earth to fend, lend me a bold ear where I packet a trunk of junk. One last look I know not the law I did not saw. Horlangs the wrong groan in drone and strip and sand, scrap log booked and hooked and crooked shaven graceland. The veneer of produce hangs up hard hatred noose, yet glues welfare spruce, coughing carbon shadows of past use, splintered future further, faster farther. Oh, who is me furtive atomic mother? I am the word and whistle of the world. Wind rushing on stage will not be seen on page. What's heard is the wage. I wrote my fate and crate, worked my system grist across the CE mark in cedar pine and cypress bark, till I had no role, no place, no face, no voice. Round and round braced, a call of the wild taste, I end as wooden waste. Thank you so much for listening to me. Thank you. I'll now open up to questions and back to you, Sarah. But thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Hamish. That was absolutely fantastic. I really enjoyed it. And I think, like many people in the audience, you enabled us to virtually travel with you onto the stage and inside some buildings that many of us haven't been able to visit for some time. So that was much needed on this January Friday lunchtime. Just a reminder to our audience that you can raise your hand if you'd like to ask Hamish a question directly, or you can type it in the Q&A box and I'll read it out on your behalf. And I think one of the slightly difficult things for speakers in this online environment is that you can't really pick up on the energy of the room. You know, people aren't giving you feedback by laughing at your jokes or nodding along enthusiastically, but I'm certain people were doing that from home, and we had nearly 50 people join us who are still with us. So that's just really nice to feel, again, like I said in my introduction, those connections to people who are really interested in your work, Hamish. But if I could use my chair's privilege to just open the questions up and start to think about some of the ideas that you raised in your presentation. Perhaps because I'm a historian of sculpture, I was really fascinated by the way in which you opened your talk, describing theatre sets as bespoke sculptural conglomerations and also as complex sculptures. And I just wondered what employing the idea of sculpture does for your argument, whether that's sort of conceptually and or materially, how you're thinking about these works of art as sculpture in particular, and whether you could just open that up a bit for me and for other people. That'd be a really great way to start.
Thank you. Yes, this is a really interesting point, actually. And I think that the reason why I kind of used that term is because set designs and scenography are very difficult to define, really, because it's such a broad spectrum of different processes and materials and to some extent there doesn't have to be any material. So I think that to me sculpting as well can reflect some of the range of the different practices of set designers. I think there are some set designers in the audience, so please, you know, it'd be lovely to hear from them as well. They'll correct me on this, but there are some designers who prefer to work purely through drawing and model making and not with the physical materials, but equally there are artists who work directly with the materials that end up on stage. Mm-hmm. And so to me, I maybe need to have more of a think about the way that I'm using the word sculptural, but it was to try and get a sense of that range, but also to say that sometimes there's a sort of tradition in theatre of using one material to pretend to be another material. Materials act and pretend to be other materials on stage, and again, that's, you know, in a theatre context, quite you know, a broad thing to say, I think, but I think that it's very, I think again, the sculpting and the reason for sculpting, and there was a really great exhibition on at the Serpentine Gallery by former Phantasma, I think, over, sadly it was over during the pandemic, but it was they made it very accessible, and there they worked with wood. They're not theatre designers as far as I know, but part of their sculpting was to include the ethical implications of this material, and I think that is I think ethics, again, it's maybe difficult to talk about in very broad terms like that, but from my perspective, I think it's almost another potential area to consider and to for artists and designers to push their work in different directions. And there's lots of sort of fascinating and interesting examples of that, because I think that certainly environmental ethics can be quite quite daunting and quite domineering and or feel quite restrictive, and so rephrased. I think part of my intention is to try and discuss around rephrasing this as a creative process.
Great, thank you, Hamish. Danny, do we have anyone with their hand raised at the moment?
Yes, we have a Ginny Manning would like to ask a question, so I'm just going to unmute them now.
Great, thank you.
Hello, hi Hamish. Hello, Sarah.
Hi.
Hamish, that was fascinating. Thank you so much. I'm just interested, being a playwright, and obviously after everything that's happened over the last few months, and how we are reconsidering the state of theatre. I think there's quite a big change in how we're approaching theatre and inclusivity and diversity. In terms of making theatre, this idea of including the importance of everybody involved, I think, is really relevant. Could you kind of give me, as a theatre maker, one piece of advice that kind of, as a starting point from what you've just discussed, in terms of bearing in mind the importance of the script and also bearing in mind the importance of the other craft people? Like, just like a sort of a simple piece of advice of where to start, because it's obviously based a lot on all, as a theatre maker, you know, you kind of, I'm sure you know this, you sort of start off writing for two characters and a black box set because you've got no budget. and as you progress, then that obviously becomes more complex. So basically, what advice would you give us?
Thank you, Ginny. I think that's a very interesting question. I think you know, and obviously there's not a correct answer, you know, one correct answer to that question. But I've found being in conversation with different people who work in theatre, have different roles in theatre, and again, I feel I'm saying the same point again, but the complexity of theatre with all sorts of different voices, and practically you unfortunately can't talk to everybody, and everybody has their own sort of experiences and expertise and their own voice. But I found again, particularly in my own work, that it's very useful to just simply start having conversations with people that work in theatre in different roles, and there's often a lot of assumptions and vocabulary as well that comes out of that. I mean, at the National Theatre, there were lots of words that again, to people who work in that environment, are use all the time as a shorthand. But I thought it was really just interesting to kind of, in terms of a linguistic interest and playwriting interest, to draw out some of those words and the meanings of them. So there's that aspect. I also found just kind of considering the technical aspects and the pragmatic aspects through a creative lens, and particularly looking at playwrights, again Beckett is the obvious example, with very kind of almost a technical language, but that's I feel ambiguous and open enough for interpretation, and that kind of simplicity of it, I feel resonates with technical forms of theatre. But there is absolutely also nothing wrong with just starting with two characters and in a space, I think there's absolutely different ways that at different points in the process that you might bring in aspects of backstage or materiality or an aspect of materiality. I mean, if there's a prop that you want to give to those two actors, what's the history of that prop? Where how has that been manufactured? And the stories that come out of that and following it back.
I have a question as well on the Q&A, which perhaps feeds into what you're saying. So if I can just interject with that, yeah. And it's from Barbara Hull. And she asks, she says she's interested in how that you see the education of the audience feeding into this argument, how what you're saying about sustainability. And I'm just thinking, you know, you're talking there to someone who's a playwright and a theatre maker, but then sort of in this sort of 3D aspect that you're talking about, what's the role of the audience within this?
Yeah, it's a really good point. And I think that for my own research, I'm to some extent I'm quite interested in theatre that is sort of implicitly sustainable, that as per the reading at the end, that the audience doesn't necessarily obviously know, because I think again environmental or ecological theatre can be a type of theatre, and it can have these expectations, and it can be quite didactic in some respects, and so it's but that's not to say that the audience don't have a part to play, and I think that what I said in the example of if a theatre production has an environmental message, but it produces it in an unenvironmental way, I think that there is such an opportunity for the audience to kind of engage with what a theatre is beyond just what they see on the stage. The example that I always think of, which isn't really to do with environmentalism, but there was a production of Peter Pan up here in Edinburgh, and there was in the programme, there was a piece about this prop that was used on stage, which was a patchwork quilt, which the theatre company had engaged with this charity for orphans. And one of the themes of the play was lost boys and that. So there was a real resonance between how the theatre was produced and the themes that were in this kind of fictional context. And I just loved that reality and fiction. And I think that, again, there's so much scope for that and having the audience being there. It's also probably really important to say, and, you know, particularly in the context of this year as well, that and again, this is not necessarily something that my own research will go into, but in terms of the carbon footprint of a theatre show, consultants such as Julie's Bicycle and the Green Theatre Report, which came out in 2008, the Mayor of London found that the largest carbon footprint associated with a show is the audience. And that, of course, has a huge implication, because we can treat the audience as a passive observer, but actually, if they are, sort of the travelling of the audience to the theatre is the largest part, then that's a big aspect. But I'm aware of the time as well. Yeah. And I have the tendency to just carry on.
There's so much to say. I can see that we've already reached 1 o'clock. But I think there's I can see some other questions. So we'll carry on a bit longer. And for people who have to leave, we are recording this. So, you know, if they're interested, they can, it will be available to watch. So to not worry if they do have to log out. But I think we'll just carry on for a bit longer, if that's all right with you, Hamish, just because I want to get to a few more questions whilst we've still got, and people are still staying with us. I can see how many people are here. So I think we'll just carry on and let our tummies rumble a bit more. Danny, have you got any raised hands there?
Yes, we've got another raised hand from Georgie Cunningham, so I'm just going to unmute them now.
Thank you.
Oh, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, yes. We can hear you. Great. Welcome,
Fantastic. Georgie. Fantastic. Hi, Hamish. Hi, Sarah. So I'm here with Kate Carey, who's also on the call. We're two parts of Tenderfoot Theatre, which is an eco-theatre collective. We're hoping to graduate this summer. And it's been so interesting for us watching this talk, because so much of what you've talked about has been so integral to the practice that we're trying to put kind of on its feet. So thank you so much for giving us that kind of validation, and also giving us so many ideas to kind of try and continue our work reducing our carbon footprint on that. I'm interested in your views on one particular thing, which is the relationship between script and set as an actual physical thing. And what I mean by that is that one of our practices that we want to look into is in order to reduce our paper waste, any scripts that we do use, because we're all quite holistic actors, we all like having that thing in your hand that you can make notes on and you can rip up and you can do a physical cut and paste, using any of that paper to actually build elements of the set, and incorporating those two and the relationship between those two. And we're just interested in your views on that.
Yeah, it's very interesting, and similar to the example of the where the script is projected, the script is the set design. And again, there are all sorts of ways of doing that. And again, resonances, if it's there are multiple layers in terms of if it's recycled material, and there are kind of other themes going on there. I mean, I think that practically also there are conversations about what happens the following stage once a script is ripped up into pieces. Has it lost sort of its ability to be put back together? Can you have a can the script document in itself be modular or you know be used in different ways? I think that again, there's a wealth of experimentation that can go on there, and it's very dependent on the specific for me, the narrative that's being said, and if it resonates, if as long as it's not sort of completely contrived, but I think it's another little sort of detail that can add something to the artistry of it. And again, I think, again, this is more of a practical answer, and to some extent, is that the recycled material can supposedly not have the same production value. But I think if it's very much baked into the intention of the whole production itself, then it's perfect for that. But you know, that could also be a limitation on some level. But
sorry, Hamish, to interrupt you with your flow there, but just again, another question that sort of intersects into this. So I'm just, you know, trying to push in as many things as we can. This is from Jess Curtis. And she says, as a designer, I often keep my scripts for my projects as they become an artifact, relic, memory of the whole experience. And people involved with the changes and the final notes and first thoughts. If an electronic document is often recommended as an environmentally responsible choice for a production, how might that affect the archaeology of these documents? Because of course, actually in your presentation, you use a lot of kind of archive material, and we're drawing from paper archives. So it's interesting in this kind of changing ecology of the analog and the digital, what's happening to the script in this process. So I just wanted to sort of intersect with Jess's thoughts, because I thought that connected to what Georgie was asking you there as well.
Thank you. Yes. No, it's a really good point. And I think that actually to answer both questions simultaneously, if possible, I think the script document, you know, as I sort of said at one point, at what point in the process does it exist? And there are always a lot of revisions, and sometimes there isn't really a script at all. It's just because there's so many individual pieces that are kind of either improvised or a document is produced that day. So sometimes it's not a physical thing that exists in its entirety. I mean, I think that's quite often the case, perhaps. But considering it as an archive document, and again, interesting in terms of Georgie's point about using it in the set design itself could become the archive of it, and that obviously there are storage implications of that, but if the script was used as a physical document, it can suggest information, suggest knowledge about that object at a later stage as well. So you know, there is a I think that the script is a sort of transient thing. It can find new meaning in historical or personal interest, and again be juxtaposed if there's a very traditional script with a kind of completely different dramatic process that's maybe doesn't use the scripts or uses a different vocabulary. How, you know, if you did an experiment to kind of throw those two traditions together, what would come out of that, and how would it evolve? But certainly the script as a kind of archival document, I think, is really important.
Great, thank you. Yeah, and for future, it's a real question, isn't it, for future researchers and how we have access to this material as well. Danny, are there any other raised hands?
No, there's none for now, Sarah.
Okay, well, I'm just going to go to Julie Young's question, and this is probably the last question that we've got time for in this live webinar, but I'm sure Hamish would take your questions by email or, you know, find ways to connect with him after the event. But Julie wants to ask you about around the issue of sustainability and the redesign of props for other plays. And if you could just expand on that idea as well. And she also thanks you for your amazing talk.
Well, thank you. Yes, I mean, I think the redesign of props or redesign of set elements, I mean, in terms of the context of the script, something that I'm quite interested in is shifting to work more seasonally rather than individual performances, and whether different performances can have resonances with each other, even just very subtly. They have to be their own individual thing, but I think that there is also an opportunity for kind of poetry and resonance and to go across a season. And so something that I've talked about with a few set designers previously is what would happen if you different production teams said for one season we're going to use these same materials, we're going to put on very different sorts of performances, but we're going to reinterpret them. And I think that there are artists who've done processes like that, and absolutely that can't be done for all theatre, but there would be lessons that would be learned to come out of that. And I think again it would just be an interesting way to question convention and I think also meaning in what we impose linguistically onto props and sets is very important. A chair is not just a chair, or is a chair just a chair if we sit on it? If we stand on it, is it a chair anymore? I mean, without getting into the existential realms of that.
But, well, I feel that's a perfect place to kind of draw to a close, as I can just imagine everyone standing on their chairs and questioning convention, because surely that is the work of all of us who are engaged in research out there, to kind of keep that in at the forefront of our minds as we do our work. Hamish, thank you so much for a really thought-provoking talk. I mean, we've had so many questions, and I can see in the chat box people are really kind of responding to your ideas, and I think taking away a lot with them today. So thank you to you, and thank you to everyone who's attended and helped us have such a rich discussion and response to Hamish's talk. And we invite you back. We have another research lunch on January the 22nd about photography and the Caribbean. So we hope that you'll come back and join us for that, and have a look at the range of other talks and events we've got running through this spring term. And we hope that you'll share the recording of this webinar with other people that you know who are interested but couldn't be with us today. And I want to thank the PMC team, particularly Danny, our events assistant, and Ella, our events manager, for running this event so smoothly. But I hope you'll all join with me in doing a virtual, very big round of applause to Hamish, and thank him for providing us with so much food for thought on a Friday lunchtime. So thanks ever so much, Hamish.
Thank you, my pleasure, and thank you to everybody at the Paul Mellon for facilitating this today. It was really enjoyable, and you know, theatre is about audience, and you know, but don't worry about standing ovations. I'll just assume that's happening.
Great.
But thank you so much, and please do get in touch if you wish to follow up. I'm sure that. There are means to do that through this event today.